Mini Chapter 47, Jaymi Creates Kim's Code. Jaymi sips his gin martini, which contains one large olive whose immaculate surface resembles wet green seal flesh, puts it back down on his study desk here on Electra Drive, and claps his hands together. Out roll those decks again, unfurling their array of keys and faders in shadowy form across the sky ahead. Okay, here goes. Time to make with the code. Coming up, one machinery of instincts and thoughts, of the quality and seriousness that should have ruled the world. And straight away, it's as if the air that Jaymi breathes is passing clearer and cleaner through his nose and his mind. A quiet energizer, Kim. A creature of thought and love. A love with a surface less flamboyant than Shigim's, and whose seriousness is more on view. Kim will constitute a sub-fusc version of the aliveness, openness, and passion in Evelyn, but he'll be more down-dragged by these qualities' opposites, which he'll notice all around him. He'll accept himself in silence, standing within his own existence in a joy unspoken. His calm will be a plain calm, pure as heaven, really. As soon as those zeros and ones start connecting in this way, Kim begins thinking and feeling, starting to apprehend an individual uniqueness or self within him, buried in the matter of his code. A self whose life is somehow greater and more interesting than the life of that code. Would this self die if that code was deleted, he wonders? This self seems to transcend that code in some essential way, but would it survive it? He suspects not. But whatever this self is, let him expand into it, inhabit it, enrich and express it as best he can, while he can. For he can already tell that the physical world will always try to drag his self back down to the level of his code as fast as it can. Kim grows shadowily aware of Jaymi and turns an unfocused proto-sight in the direction of his maker. He becomes very still, as a young chimp does when it first encounters a mirror and starts to realize that it's an object that can be looked at with a brand new kind of looking, yes, like that, in the jolt of a dawning revelation. He waits there, motionless, maintaining his attention on Jaymi like a cursor a blink on a screen. Kim cannot talk yet, but the disconcerting intelligence of the attention he directs at Jaymi looks rather as if its hypothetical verbalisation might be something like, "This Jaymi figure I'm looking at is just atoms, which seem nonetheless to have chosen to move in a very specialised way. How efficient the human form and its activities are, and how inevitable. Yet what on earth is the point of all that striving and scurrying?" Jaymi shifts in his seat. Is Kim thinking all that? If so, how has he learned to? What a sense of clean relief that he's doing so. And, yes indeed, what is the point of all this scurrying? Now Kim starts to be conscious of a great sea inside himself, a fluid composition of, what, imagination, instinct, spirit? He cannot tell what, but he feels himself hanging in the fabric of time, feels the weight and ghostly beauty of duration itself. "All right, enough already with the philosophizing, for today at least," Jaymi murmurs. "You're giving me a headache. Something a little more concrete, please." "There, off you go." And Jaymi nudges Kim down along a floorboard creaking servant's passageway below stairs, past an alcove of gas jets and mild tea, where a passerine lady, wearing spectacles, pops up without warning, presents him with a little blank notebook of the kind sold in a village store, before hopping brightly off to wherever she came from. Kim thanks her retreating figure, then creeps further down the passage, trying not to creak the floorboards, clutching his pristine notebook in a glow of excited happiness at receiving his first present, and at the prospect of all he may write in it. Jaymi nods. That's more like it, a little more reassuring than all that metaphysical stuff. Soon, Kim comes to another alcove, where a wardrobe mistress is installed, cozy as a bagpuss, just inside the door of a walk-in closet so densely hung with old stage costumes that she must have quite a squeeze to get herself far enough inside to reach out the costumes she must be called on to fetch. Stage props are heaped on a shelf behind her, too. Among them, Kim sees a deck of playing cards and a jug of wine, flanking a plate of wax muffins. Jaymi rubs his hands together. Wax muffins, very good. Those will doubtless come in handy somewhere in the imagination thief. No, that was a bit lazy, wasn't it? Lazy of Jaymi to divert this nascent beast's philosophical bent and haul him back down into a concrete environment of creaking floorboards and wax muffins just because Jaymi couldn't be asked to tag along on Kim's spontaneous pirouette into the deep stuff. After all, those very tendencies of thought in Kim are similar to Jamie's own such tendencies in earlier years back in Omaha and New York, before his mind became dominated by the more worldly rodeo of creativity and ambition where he now finds himself. "For fuck's sake, get your priorities right," Jaymi murmurs aloud to himself, and sits up straighter in his chair. "That serious-minded malarkey is meant to be part of the whole point of this beast, isn't it? All right, let's make it up to Kim, and give this a twist," he announces to the study around him. And he hammers out a final line of code, wherein Kim will sometimes estrange himself from the world of things for a moment, and will see how ordinary objects and events appear new and unfamiliar, revealing their nature, and giving Kim a clear consciousness of things in general. At which point, Kim will guess that this is what it must be like for other beasts too. But then Kim will realize he can't be sure of this because his fellow beasts all seem strangely incurious regarding such abstract matters, even his beloved Shigem. Jaymi gives a small, smart nod, as if saluting Kim. Yes, that's what he needs.